Welcome to our Pilgrim Nutcracker banner. This is a unique banner. We've got a clock up here that is four-season banner topper. Alright, I cut my rock lawn so that it would fit within the holder that I'm going to be using. So you'll want to adjust yours. The measurements are in the pattern packet. But then what I did is I cut it a little bit long. I don't know how long exactly I want this yet, and I'm not sure where I'm going to end up. So I just went ahead and cut it long, but I'm going to prep the whole thing the same way. Alright, so what we're going to do is we're going to roll with a 2-inch foam roller. I've got my nonstick mat here for easy cleanup. And I'm going to go ahead and give it a one coat of the bleach sand because, and even though the color is very close to the background, I want one coat of my base coat on and then let it dry, and then I can go back and I can do my slip slap and it won't lift the color off, exposing the color behind it. In this case, it probably wouldn't matter too much, but I'm going to go ahead and just get my first coat on anyway. This has a little bit of a funny texture that will show if it's not quite base coated all the way. I am using rock lawn, and I am on the rough side of the rock lawn. That's the choice that I made today. I'm going to go ahead and prep all four of my seasonal panels at the same time because the prep for rock lawn is, you know, kind of the bugaboo. It just takes a little bit of extra time to dry and stuff. Just work it into the texture of the rock lawn. Okay, the next thing we're going to do, I'm dry here. Sometimes a little bit of nubs kind of raise up on this rock lawn when you get it rolled. So I'm going to take my sanding disc, just knock them down. Just, I don't know what that is, but it's not as fun to paint. That'll happen on your floor cloth as well, even if it's just canvas. It doesn't have anything to do with the rock lawn. It seems to be, I don't know, something to do with the canvasy texture. Okay, so we're going to slip slap the bleach sand in the background. So we'll kind of re-wet our surface. Just, it doesn't have to be even, it just needs to be re-wetted. And my rock lawn's not quite, it's cool to the touch, it's not quite dry yet. So probably could have let it dry. And then we're going to roll into the front part of the toe of our roller, and we're going to roller slip slap. And if we get any polka dot kind of patterns, then we'll use the back side to kind of blend them down. And so just kind of do a little kind of action. And you want to be careful not to overstir the pot because you will make mud. Okay, and we want it kind of a dirty, whitish kind of color. We want some of that texture and movement in the background. So I think that's about right. We could use a sponge for this, but I think it would be too speckly and too splotchy. Okay, one of the ideas that we're going to do is I'm going to drill a hole in here. I'm going to cut out my background paper clock, and I'm going to put my clock on here and then do a faux finish on this part of the clock that will tie it in with this antiqued paper or tea-stained paper. Okay, so the very first thing I want to do is go ahead and treat this exactly like my banners that I'm going to hang. I thought that it would be great for my banners to hang that off the clock in the same color pattern. So I'm going to go ahead and roll and do my edges and borders however I want them. If you're real careful and don't mess it up like I just did, you can leave it that dark laser cut color and it won't look terrible. So we'll do exactly the same technique. We're going to pick up the nose of the roller and give it that distressed, slip-slapped kind of look. And then we'll glue the paper on top of this. We've got our background on and it's dried and I've traced my pattern on. Next, what I'm going to do is I'm going to use Texture Crackle Medium, and I'm going to mix two puddles, one with bleach sand, and one with desert sand. Okay, this is non-tinted, so you can put more of paint in it than you can with the tinted version, so that's why I like the non-tinted. You can tint it with any color paint you got. And it's thixotropic, meaning that it's going to get a little bit thinner the more you kind of smoosh with it. It comes out kind of stiff, but now it gets kind of creamy. Okay, so I'll make a little puddle. I don't need very much of it. Just until I've got it tinted so it looks about like the color is what I'm going to add. Make sure I've got it mixed in there. So I'm using these background colors is what my thought process is. Then I'll go ahead and I'll do the same thing with the desert sand. All right, I'm going to use a three-sided squeegee, and I'm just going to pick some of this up and put some here and there going in and out of my design. Maybe I'll mix just a little bit of extra. So you just pick it up on there. It's not very thick. And what I like about this is it just adds just another element to the piece. You want it kind of thin because it's on a flexible canvas. Just adds that one more layer, brings it more into, instead of just a some kind of painted something or another, it makes it a like home decor item. It's going to match other things you might have in your house because this textured kind of looks are very popular right now, so it's going to be something that not only, you know, if you ended up with it hanging longer than just Thanksgiving, you'd be cool. Get a little bit up here in this fat area. If I needed to, I could glaze if my colors weren't quite right, sitting together enough. Okay, I think. Helps if you have something on your... I tried the palette knife on the first Nutcracker banner that I did, and I wasn't as happy with the palette knife because it wasn't wide enough. Definitely the three-sided squeegee is a good winner for making good wide swaths without a whole bunch of lines. The very first thing I'm going to base coat while I'm waiting for my background to dry is the leaf area. I'm going to use Camel, and I'm going to use this MD shader. This is a super fine, not fine like thin fine, but a super fine sharp-edged floating tool or basing tool. And in this case, I've got all these leaf points here. I'm going to want to slide right on in, and I don't want any messing around. I don't want fluffy-edged brushes. I want a brush in very good condition. I could go around and do my outer edges and then come in the inside and base coat normally. You do want to be careful if you ever kind of go around things that you don't end up leaving ridges that get in your way. And you can sand canvas, so if you have a problem, just get out your sanding disc and give your canvas a little sand. I will go ahead and I will base coat all of the leaves in one body. I'm going to paint them all the same color, and then I'll transfer my line on to show the separations, and then I'll start decorating them. Okay, we need to knock back a little bit of texture. Sometimes when you base coat on the rock lawn, you get just a little bit of texture. So I'm going to use my sanding disc. And then I want to knock back any high, real high points on the texture. Keep it out of my wet paint. Anytime you get any ridges, you can knock them back as well. Okay. Then what I want to do is I want to shade to separate my leaves. Oh, actually, what we have to do next is do some dry rubbing. We've got these giant bristle scumblers. Here's the deal. They come flat like that so that they're very blunt. And what I needed was to make them into like a dome stencil brush because my dome stencil brush supplier does not seem to carry very many of those brushes anymore. So what I did is I just took my scissors, and these are real inexpensive brushes so you don't have to feel like you're torturing it, and I just trimmed it so that I wouldn't have a blunt edge. And because they're nice and scumbly, they're gonna make just an excellent background technique. So we use a dry rubbing technique, which is dry paper towel, dry brush, and dry paint. And we're gonna go into our espresso and dry off all the paint. And then I've got my first base coats done, which is awesome. And I'm going to just start working in this color behind here. And then I'll just fix my base coats. May need to go into something just a touch lighter. So as I pull out of here, or to begin with, whichever way you want to go, I'm going to go into khaki tan. And that'll just be a little bit lighter. I just want him setting into this background just a little bit. I'll go up the edges. I don't want to bring it too far up. But I do want him kind of cupped within a little frame. Just bring it straight on up the edges. I'm on this nonstick mat, so this stuff will wipe right off of there after I get done. You'll decide how far down you want it. And this is going to catch on all those little textures that you've got on there. Excellent background technique. And first you put the texture in. You get the texture of the crackle already. Then you put the texture in. And then the dry rubbing catches on everything and enhances it all. That out. When we get it where we want it, then we'll go into and deepen with our brown. And sometimes you can just stipple. And then that's going to be in the very edgy edge. See why we're doing this before. We could have done this with the just the tracing on, but I didn't want, what I don't want to do is trace and then trace again and then trace again kind of thing. So what I'll do is, because I can still see my lines, I'll just use one coat in on the edges, and then I'll just clean everything up. You definitely want to be on the pieces that you're shading next to, because what will happen is you'll end up with a glowing aura if you avoid them. We don't want that. Just at those very edges. All right, the next thing I'm going to do is I'm going to put my Harlequin stencil, and this is a distressed Harlequin, which means that it has these little hanging things that look like it's, you know, distressed. We're going to use khaki and the espresso. Lay that up alongside. I do a whole one. And we just want the hint of it, oops, as we get up higher. Yeah, that's just going to be a little hint. It's just a little background kind of motif. They don't all have to show as much as each other. Some can be heavy on the edges. I've got tack it over and over again on the back side, which makes your stencil all sticky and tacky, and then that's going to match the other seasons that we've got, and we'll repeat on the other side. All right, the very first thing we need to do is get our pattern on, and then shade to separate all of our stuff, all of our leaves. I'm going to just use cocoa to separate, do my first separation. This is going to get deeper and darker. I'm using a curved flat brush, which is curved on one side and flat on the other. It is a fantastic brand spankin' new brush, never before invented or seen that I am aware of. OK,
Okay, and I'm just going to go ahead and shade next to everything. The nice thing about the curved flat is I can go in with the rounded edge and I can just tickle down any harsh lines that I get with my floats. And we've got a whole bunch of other stuff we get to do with this. I'm leading with the square edge. I can tuck straight on in. I don't seem to need as much water to float with this brush. I don't know if it's holding more water or what it's doing, but I'm able to kind of float pretty dry. Not worry about running out of stuff. So I'm going to shade everything. I'm going to shade the under edge of everything that is on top. And so you got to make some decisions and decide who's on top. You could make, you could use your triple threat Ghost Rider, and you could put a T on the top ones. Yes, this is top. This one's bottom. So you would shade on the bottoms, on all the bottoms. Everything that has more details. So like this has got all these leaf shapes. This one's a bottom. Okay. And we'll just shade around all the edges. Try to keep all your points soft and round. The points where your points meet. For example, I go around this point. I don't want to leave a point in the middle of my leaf. All right, next what we're going to do is we're going to load with Espresso. And then load it kind of sharp on the edge. Not real super duper blended, so I'm actually going to try and pick up a little sharpness. And I want to go in where the things are the deeply darkest. And I'm going to just swipe in. Not a full swipe. Let's go on in there. If that's bent up, then as soon as that dries, I'll go and finish the swipe and it'll lift that end up. The deeper your shadow is, the higher away from the object that you're shading. So I want that one to be closer, so I'll make it skinnier. And then maybe this is higher up. So this end would be wider, casting a little bit of a wider shadow. Gotta be careful, because as I come around that corner, I want to make sure that I'm not making a mess. And we're going to do some dry rubbing and stuff like this. This is just to cinch everything into the edges of the leaf. Then we'll rub and bring colors out. So where you see these darkest edges, where the little swoops are and things, and just go ahead and give those something to lift them up. And then if you do it there, you've got to bring at least a little edge here to show that that's on top. Let's just see how that lifts it away. Okay, now we're going to take these short, stipply, very, very coarse brushes that are very tightly put together, and we're going to take them and dry rub to set some of these leaves down. Make sure that you're completely dry. Take off the B's and T's. Those Ghost Riders erase with spit, varnish, and erasers. So they're super awesome for disappearing. So dry paint, dry brush, dry paper towel. Now, some of these leaves are kind of strange because they're under things. So I'm going to go ahead and make them settle down and not be very bright. And so I'll set that back just by rubbing down with a hint of a color. And where it's out in the sunshine, it can have a little bit more presence. So I won't take this color all the way out. Okay, so we'll just tone that one down, and then I think we need to kind of bring this corner of this guy down. He's just kind of in there and under a bunch of stuff, so we'll go here and tickle this down. You can close your eyes and do this technique. It's very easy. And then we'll extend some of this shading into the leaf just a little bit to make it belong. Now the same thing is happening right here with this leaf, and I think we need to change tactics. Now we'll go ahead and we'll do the brown. So I'll go here and we'll just, because he's sitting under a couple of, he's actually over this leaf on this side, so we've got to make him under on this side. And then he's definitely sitting under stuff over here. This will connect your shadow to the outer edge of your leaf, so you don't have to float real big. Flip it over and use the paint on the other side.
And just scrub and scumble. Okay, now some of the leaves are starting to pop up on top. This guy over here definitely has the same thing going on.
My movement is not back and forth, it's kind of little circles. My brush angle is turned back. I'm leaning back on my brush.
Okay, now he's settled down just a little bit, and then we can go back to these. This guy right here seems like he's still just a little bit harsh.
So I can fade that into the shadow and bring it
as a medium value out there.
We could wash this area, and we're not done yet, so we'll just grow this thing as it grows.
All right, so he's a little bit sudden there. All right, I'm going to start with the persimmon color.
Rub that off. I'm going to start tucking in some color here and there. I want to fade it into a little bit of just the yellow. And let's see.
Some of these are going to be more catchy than others. So this might be an orangey leaf, and this one down here might have more yellow on the tips because it's at the bottom.
I'll start just by getting some colors in there.
Okay, what a fun, fast, easy way to add color.
You can start off gentle and then just increase.
You don't have to get all the way there first thing.
Some orange. We're going to have some orange kissed on everybody.
Now just a little bit, I think. I'm going to keep going with my orange and kind of finish those off. But I want to go and deepen in my brown areas. I might have just leaped up just a little bit too fast. So I'm going to go in with a little bit of traditional burnt sienna and orange up my browns, but it won't matter because it'll layer. So, fine if they layer. Getting some more brighter colors on here is going to be much better. On the oak leaves, maybe we'll just keep the orange up near the tip and let the tips be yellow.
Did I just say that backwards? We'll keep the yellow at the tip and let the back of the leaf be orange, however that works out.
Okay, so after you're done getting something floated and you're sure you like where it's at, or after you're done getting the color on there and you're sure you like where it's at, then you can go in and float to clean up the edge and strengthen the color. Okay, so now that just totally makes that a much stronger presence.
So that is the technique that we're going to use. We're just going to work our way around these leaves. It's going to kind of depend on your touch and your style. We can also then go into the traditional burnt sienna. And then that's that technique I said we were going to go ahead and redden up some of our shading and create a little bit warmer environment. Okay, and that deeper kind of look. That's a nice red brown. Not so dastardly dead. I'm going to go back in and I'm going to strengthen some of these accents. Had a few days away from the project. I came back and I didn't like how bright I wasn't. So I'm going to go ahead and strengthen that. If your brush is too wet, you'll leave a little blob. Then I'm going to take out my, this is the new curved flat brush. It's curved on one side and flat on the other, so you can use it as a stroke brush or a flat brush, which is just cooler than all coolness. I'm going to show you, too, that the brush basin that I'm using, besides the fact that it's filthy, has, every now and again, you just come across something that is new and it's different and great enough that it's awesome. Number one, I can get my entire hand in this back basin. I fill it only halfway so that when I'm swashing my brush out or something like that, I'm not splashing out of my container. If you're a terrible floater, this back little well here can be just brilliant for you. You can fill this with a mixture of color float and water, and then you can load just into that, and it gives you a nice little lip to load from, like a controlled float. And you can also put the brush cleaner in this and clean your brush and then keep this basin right here for only the stuff that had the brush cleaner in it so you don't get that contaminated in your other waters. Then of course these two front ones have the scraper on the bottom, so if you have stuff that needs to be scraped out or whatever. The thing that I love the best about this is when I'm going to use my Raphael liner. Raphael liner is made out of sable hairs, and it really, really needs a little bit of wake-up time. So I swish it in water, and I place it right here. And then what it does is that the water saturates those natural fibers in the hairs, and it makes my lining go much better. Also, as I'm using all these crescent brushes, what happens is as I clean them, I put them here to show me that they're the wet ones. And then I can bring that batch down and the new batch up as I cycle through. Anyway, just something to know about. I'm going to leave this brush dirty, and I am going to load this curved flat into water just like I normally would. And I'm going to float the edges of these leaves so that you can kind of see how that goes. Okay, so I'll load just like normal. I'm loading on the flat edge of the brush. And now see where I have this area right here, where there's a glowing yellow area. So what I'll do, now that I've dry rubbed, I know where my paint's gonna go. And I'll float right next to that. Okay, and so what that does is it looks like I floated that big old long thing because it's nice and faded. Now I don't wanna go in and I don't wanna cut through my floats. So I'm going to just do one little sides at a time on all the areas and allow my float to dry before I go and float again. Okay, so that's what we're gonna do now. We're gonna go into the areas where we dry rubbed and we'll float next to the edge so that it looks like that float connected all the way in. Okay, we're gonna strengthen some of the dry rubbing, and I can do this dirty brush with a little bit of the traditional burnt sienna, and just to brown it up just a little bit. And that'll just make it rich. And I'm going to shade some of my tips with the orange and some with that burnt sienna color. And make sure that you smooth out any transitions so that you can't tell where they stop and start. And you can go back in after you get that float on there and you can add a little bit of more depth. and definitely take yourself away from it so that you can kind of see what you're doing. It's easy to get kind of carried away just rubbing everywhere. And it just seems, it's actually so easy, it seems like such a random activity that I think it can be really hard to say, yeah, I'm shading here. Because when you float, you know, you put it down exactly in one spot. I'm going to take a little burnt umber. I'm going to tuck in where things get darker and where I can't tell what's happening with the leaves. Like if I can't see that that leaf's on top of that leaf, I want to increase that contrast. I don't want to do it everywhere. That would be like outlining kind of. I like to especially do it where things are folded or have little circly poos. Okay, so we'll go here. These back leaves can be fairly dark. You could even wash in a little umber if you wanted to. Wash it out like to here so it just shows that it's in the shadow. Okay, this is going to be so cute. Okay, next I'm going to use that Raphael that I soaped. I've got the number 4 out because I want healthy sized veins. I'm going to use a mix of, just a brush mix. I'm going to use a brush mix of my traditional burnt sienna and burnt umber. And we're going to put these veins in. Now, if you're nervous about putting veins in, then what I recommend is taking your Triple Threat Ghost Rider and use the gray or the white ceramic lead, and then just give yourself a line to follow. Because if you do straight clunky lines, then it's going to be kind of ugly. And these lines come off with spit, water, varnish. Okay. So we're just going to, and you can't see anything I'm about to do. Okay, I need it juicier. Tapered at the ends. And then pull the veins into the leaf. And we'll do that on all of our leaves. So I'm loving my leaves. Okay, that's great. And I'm looking up here and I see that I have my base coats for my nutcracker. And I see these bright leaves down here and I see this drab nutcracker started out right here. So I realize that what I have is I have an isolated section of color. Now I could dry rub up the sides, but you can't have all orange here and then not have some kind of repeat up here. I don't want to make this like a clown nutcracker. I want them to be pilgrim-esque. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to mix my traditional burnt umber, burnt sienna, with burnt umber, and I'm going to create a reddish brownish coat on him and hat. I want it to really lean a little to the orange to carry that color up and to create a little bit more richness. He just got a little bit too drab. And the reality is we can make this our reality, if that makes any sense. We don't have to be drab, drab brown. We have to create an impression of a pilgrim without shattering it with like putting like baby blue on him or something like that. But we can bend it to whatever we want for the art, for the sake of the actual art itself. So I think that that's going to help quite a bit. You can already see the color going up one side. See how this is almost lifeless over here. So I think that that's going to be the right step. And I'll do his hat the same way. Okay, now we're going to do all of these khaki areas with bleach sand and a crescent stencil brush. This is where the skinniness, this is so microscopically skinny. This is where this is brilliant. I can get such great control out of that. If I needed to and I wanted to block an area, say my leaf is done, and I wanted to get straight on in there, I could just mask it. Whoops. And then it doesn't look like it's got that halo effect. We're going to go ahead and do the same thing to his cuffs. I'm going to highlight the middle. That's going to give his arm roundness. Okay, we want to be careful to wipe off all of our color. I I can go back into this and just touch without barely wiping off at all if I want to give him a little bit shinier kind of cuff, a little bit stronger. Pilgrims probably shouldn't be very shiny, but okay, now here, his chest is going to be bigger in these two areas because that's where the roundness falls. So we'll go into the middle of the chest area. It's going to hit, this is coming off over his shoulder. Now what this dry rub of this bleach sand color is doing for us is it is creating that khaki color. So this is what dry rubbing is cool. This is what's cool about dry rubbing. So I base coated in my middle value. By dry rubbing over it with this bleach sand color, what I'm doing is creating a wonderful shade that's real easy. So it's a neat way of not having to float everything into big giant float moments. Now I'm gonna go rounded strokes here. Just the flat of my brush. You can pretty much scumble any way you want to with this. Now we have another isolated color situation on our guy here. We've got that teal color. And frankly, I don't know if the teal color is gonna get to stay or not. But what I could do is I could trim this in the teal color. So we're gonna see, I'll wait and see and kind of play it by ear. I'll increase the strength of that once I'm sure it's dried. You can hear me scrubbing. Okay, let's see how that's increasing the color. And I'll just do it like that until I'm sure that I get the look that I want. I'm on the rough side, and what this is doing for me, which is kind of cool, which is what dry rubbing is intrinsically does, is it's creating texture because I'm on the rough side of this canvas. So it's actually looking like a homespun cloth look. About where I want it, I might add a little bit more. When the areas on your socks and cuffs and collar are all dry, then go ahead and use burnt umber and shade. We'll shade and we'll do a flip float here in the leg area. We'll shade on that side and then we'll shade on the opposite side. I had made one of his legs way bigger than the other. Okay, and then we'll shade under things where things disappear behind. I'll just see if that bugs me. I think that's gonna, yeah, I guess by the time maybe I'll spatter in that area. Okay, so then we'll shade up here and down here too, but not right now because that's wet. I don't wanna cut through a float. And we'll shade around his cuffs. And on his collar, I don't like about filming and doing this is that I have to keep juggling with my palette gets in the way. Okay, so we're going to shade under his neck before we put his beard on. That way it'll be shaded under there. And then, of course, over the front of, or the shoulders. And we can walk this down his legs just a little bit. And of course, he's going behind the pumpkins and leaves, so that needs to be shaded as well. Okay, we're gonna use our crescent brush. These, you know, they're so skinny that you think they can't make a good round, but watch what we do in the middle of his face. Dry rub it all off, dry brush, dry paint, all that. You just scumble in a nice little circle-y. And we're going to create that area of his face that's bringing forward or coming forward. So once again, if we were doing this another way, we could base it the light color and then shade, shade, shade. But we don't need to do that because we're going to add that middle value area in with this easy technique. Make sure you have many of these brushes, though. That's the key, is having multiples. At least two sets, I would say. Okay, I think I'm going to need just a little bit more in the middle. Make his face nice and bright. I'll wait till that dries and bring it up. Now we want to do his hand at the same time. He's got another little hand over here that I haven't base coated yet because, why haven't I? I've got to do this basket detail. That's going to be something that I want to make sure his hand sits over my basket and not my basket going around his hand, if that makes any sense. Set that aside while I'm waiting, and then we can shade. And our shade color is Shading Flesh. This is the same color as the other Nutcrackers in this series. Now I want to do a soft float with Shading Flesh. What does soft float mean? It means I'm going to use a little more water, a little less paint, because I don't want a stripy little face here. I'll take that to the hat band, and I'm going to leave it. I'm going to get out of that area. I'll come down over here and do a C-stroke around his hands. We'll go over here and we'll do a little kind of C-stroke action under his chin. I'll wait for those to dry, and then I'll finish doing my shading. All right, next we'll do his face. I'm going to base his hair all with the slate gray. Okay, so it's going to be, well, that. We'll base his mustache as well. We've got to put some cheeks on this guy before we get too crazy with our mustache, so I'll just base this main area. I want to wash his nose with a little bit of bleach sand. It'd be nice to get a little face on him. They say if you want to make sure you finish pieces, then you go ahead and you put their face on first so they look at you and they make you feel guilty. Okay, and his teeth get a little bit of this bleach sand as well. His eyes, their base bleach sand. Don't forget his eyebrows when you're basing. Okay. I'm going to dry rub the cheeks, the autumn red. And we're going to just use a little tiny 1/8 size dry rubbing brush. Keep it under control. Now he's a pilgrim, so he's outside and he is probably fairly flushed, right? Just cut right on through that mustache. That's what'll make everything look a little more realistically layered, if you will, as if you make sure that you don't have halos around things. Okay, we don't want to get him too clowny. Okay, so I'm going to continue my base coating. Okay, I want to do a really controlled float. I based his eyes with the Salem blue. Really controlled float means I'm going to do it very, very scant water, very scant everything. So, blot my brush a little bit more. Just pick up on the very corner. I've got my curve flat out again. I'm going to have him looking down towards that little turkey. So we're going to shade his eyes over here. And clean up with that rounded edge if I want to. And just gives him nice vivid eyes. Then because, look at how pointy this Raphael brush gets. Because it does get so pointy, we're going to go into a little bit of graphite and we're going to give him his pupils down here. kind of give him not really a dot, more like a little teeny bit of a squiggle. And then we need to give him some reflection. So I'm going to dry out my brush. I'm going to give him a bit of reflection in his eyes. If they don't have reflection in their eyes, they're dead. Just in case you were wondering. Right, so now his eyes are all done. I could give him with the white in my brush just a little bit of a nose highlight if I wanted to. And now we'll go ahead and load for the hair. We're going to do first graphite, which is our gray, and water. We want water in our brush. And we're going to swirl. Now we also need to shade. But right now I'm going to go ahead and just add my swirls. He's got curly locks. So they're going to curl every which way. Mustache, same thing, shape following. Okay, beard, same thing, that way. That way and that way. Looks like I need to extend that down a little bit further. Okay, and his eyebrows, get a little bit of a coif as well. And now we'll get out the white highlight. We can go dove gray plus white depending on how bright you want things to jump. I think I'm going to skip straight to white. And so, a little bit more water. A little less water. I'll get it right. Blot that puppy. We're just overlapping. Down here. Okay, now I'm painting upside down. I'm going to flip them over so that I can get just a little bit more of a feel for where I'm going. He's got to have his brows a little bit. And just keep working at it until you feel like you've got it under control. And then we'll shade. And you could add a little bit more after you get done shading and everything. Okay, we'll take and shade his hair with graphite. Just give it some nice curls. And where it comes out of the hat, that's got to be shaded. Okay, that darkens him up a little bit, which is making me happier. Next to his face, somebody wants somebody out there, huh? Where his hair disappears under. And then where these are curls, we've got to make it so that there's a level there for the other curl to kind of come out of. It's almost like a little S thing. I did add a little a line of graphite right over his eye. That helped me feel a little bit more like his eye was anchored. I don't think I did that on the poinsettia, but I think I would. Okay, so now he's got some nice gray hair. And I guess his mustache could use just a little bit. Where it's coming together here. There we go. Right, next we're going to take care of these pants. We're going to use the Colonial Green to highlight, and we'll dry rub the highlights first. I'll show these. He's got some puffy kind of stuff going on. Keep it away from where things tuck under other things. And then I can go Colonial Green plus bleached sand. That's not quite getting bright enough because that was that mix that we used. So I'll dirty brush into some bleach sand. And I'll do this highlight within that highlight. Remember, the lighter we get it in a dark area, the more it's going to look like it's reflecting. And I don't think this Pilgrim's got reflecting clothes. Okay, maybe just a little bit more. And maybe I won't blend it out so much. Okay, we'll come up here to his hat. I'll wipe out some of that bleach sand. I'll give his hat band a little highlight. And the same thing with our little loops here. Let's give them a little highlight on the top and the bottom. Maybe around that side. Spit out a little bit more of my bleach sand for the final highlight within the highlight. And on his hat, I'm going to flatten this brush because I've already got it dirty. Okay, and that gives him a little bit of a, not quite a shine, but something like that. Okay, down here on the pants while I've got this dirty. Just strengthen those up. Okay, I just tried the graphite for my shadow. I thought I was going to use the antique, whatever this is, antique teal, but I think that this is going to work out just fine. I'm going to use graphite instead. Now he's got these poofy little pant legs there, so I'm going to go ahead and bring that in as I shade it. I have to go all the way to the edge. Okay. I'm going to bring down from here and flip them over, do the same thing on the other side. And that's called a flip float. All right, next we're going to go here into his tie area. And we're going to shade up under his mustache and really kind of just line up in there. Laying my brush down flat is not giving me the look I want. It's kind of a float, dry rub kind of pull it out thing. It's not really a good technique, it's just a thing. I'll come over here, do the same thing here. Walk it in. Okay. Next we're going to get his coat. I've neutralized my color. I'm out of dry rubbing brushes. With the heat the way it is, I think I'll have one dry again in no time. Neutralize the color. I'm using cocoa. I'm going to highlight his jacket. That's almost too big a jump. Do you see how that goes chalky right away? So I'm going to go into Cocoa Plus Espresso. Just I want to tone that down just a little bit. We'll take care of that in a little while. If you jump too many values too quick, especially when you've got a good basing color, then you end up with something that just looks solid. Okay, we'll get up here in his hat. start in the center area, work our way around. That doesn't really even have a cocoa-esque kind of look. Okay, we'll do the same thing over here on his jacket. Go all the way up. A little bit less. We won't do so many steps and things here under his arm. Pick up a little bit more cocoa, and then these are going to become the highlights. And maybe we need, yeah. I'm going to go ahead and dip my brush straight into the traditional burnt sienna. I'm so used to saying traditional burnt umber. That always slips me up. Okay, and I'm going to rub a little bit of this color, which is very orange. I might have to wash it over my highlights just a little bit. I want to warm them back a little bit. That's going to tone them down just a little, but it's also going to bring my orange back up there like I wanted. Sorry. Go into Persimmon. Same kind of deal. Just going to give him a little bit of an orange cast on either side of his highlighted area. Okay, we're just building some texture. Now I'm going to go into bleach sand, and this is going to be our little final highlight. I've got a dirty brush here. Okay, got a little bit more. Shape following. We're going to use the asphaltum. Is that asphaltum? Bittersweet chocolate, sorry. Something's wet, okay. And we're going to shade all of his jacket and everything. So we'll shade where things overlap. They end and where things are over and under. Come up here, we'll shade where his arms, my crumpling is me looking at my pattern lines. Okay, that'll give his jacket nice good depth. Up in between here. Shade under his shirt or his collar. And where his cuffs go in. On his hat, we're going to shade this brim here and make this whole area kind of darker. So it's almost like a wash under there. Doesn't have to be a technical float. The whole thing should be kind of dark. Okay, we want to shade where his hat does this little turn. Same thing on the other side. Let's see, where's that coming up at? I guess we'll skip that for right now. A shade on either side of his arms. Just that flip float kind of thing again. Shading and the highlighting are what gives roundness to your project. Get his hat done. Keep my hands out of things. Missing parts. Stay in my lines. I'm going to shade underneath the buttons with just a little line. We don't have to actually shade. I'm going to make them look like they're. And we'll do the same thing underneath the buckle here. And then on the buttons, we're going to pick up our camel color in a dry brush with my round brush. Just give them just a little bit of highlight. Finish off the highlight with a little bit of bleached sand. Pretty simple. Don't want it to get too bright, Next, we're going to take our bittersweet chocolate, and we need to make this cornucopia belly kind of deeply dark. So we'll shade with the bittersweet chocolate, and then just wash in that area. We'll take our burnt umber. And what we're going to do is shade all these little segments just to get the roundness started. It's going to have texture, so you don't have to do it too nicely. We'll shade on both sides. Next, we're going to shade underneath the cornucopia ridges with burnt umber. Make it a little heavier on the bottom. Okay, then I'll erase my white lines when I get done. Keeping this one kind of simple. I think I want to go ahead and dry brush. This is different than dry rubbing. This is where I'm going to use this small filbert type brush, and I'm going to pick up my burnt umber, and I'm going to blend it on both sides of my brush. Then I'm going to come here and streak it in just a little. This is not rubbing. Flick on my paper towel always one time. Okay, and I'm going to do the same thing coming up this way. It's just a nice way to bring that float around where it needs to be. Wash my brush. As long as I pinch out the water, I don't have to have it dry. I'm going to go into camel color, flick on the paper towel, and then this is going to give me my highlight. Probably a little bit of bleached sand. Okay, now I want to do, I base coated my fruit. I'm going to get into the color that this is, which is Hauser Light Green. And I'm going to put some highlight on my leaves with just like a dry brush, using just my round brush. And then maybe we'll go Hauser Light Green plus bleach sand for the final highlights. And I'm trying to do this wet, just to move things along. Okay, so those are highlights. We'll see if we need to shade this in the end. I want to use the light avocado, and I want to make my squash squiggles. Green squash. Now we'll take our little bit of our Hauser Light and we'll make that be a little bit more. We're going to create corn by just touching with the color camel in rose. And then we'll shade that. Okay. We're going to treat our leaves just like we did our other leaves. So we're going to get our little dry rubbing brush. And we're going to tint these edges. And then we'll float on them. So this is going to help bring our color up a little bit. So now I'll get a floater. I'm using just the persimmon color. We'll add a little stem. With the traditional burnt color. We're going to highlight on our grapes with the Colonial green. I decided to go ahead and make fantasy color grapes so that I can pull some more teal up. And I might want to go ahead and we'll shade those momentarily. These are going to be like Concord grapes. All right, we've got our pumpkin there, some kind of small pumpkin squash. And I think that's going to get shaded with our burnt umber. He's also going to get highlighted. We use the burnt umber and we'll shade the corn too. I'll have to highlight that corn one more time. I'm going to take my nice pointy Raphael and go back in and highlight that corn just a little bit more. Just up the middle. Give it a corn-esque look. Okay, I'm gonna get some bleach sand. I'm gonna highlight in between on my gourd. Some microscopic little floats. And punch a hole in my color. I've got a dry palette. I'm gonna go ahead and use that blue I used in his eyes on my grapes. Okay, that gives them just a little more realistic grape kind of look. Wondering about pulling, I'm thinking I'm gonna pull a little bit of that blue down into, I've been wanting a way to pop some colors, pull a little bit of that blue where I shaded on my teals, and then I'll pull a little bit of it down his legs too. To pop in just a little bit more. We'll do the same on this hat band. And I can go nice and strong over there on the edge. There, like that. And I think I'll wash the grapes. And maybe we'll pull a little bit of that blue in our brown here. Pumpkin needs to get highlighted. I'm going to make a mix of the camel and the persimmon and make that front section and then the back section. And then just camel. And we'll highlight our apple or whatever that is back there with a little bit of orange persimmon color. And gotta have a little highlight. Take a little bit of bleach sand and we'll highlight top grapes. And I think, you know, our cornucopia can't get too bold because there's a lot of details down there, but they are definitely, you know, you can kind of tell kind of what's going on without getting too crazy about it. All right, got to finish my hand. I want to take a little bit of Hauser Light Green and I'm going to dry rub a little bit here and there in my leaves. This is going to bring some of my greens up. Don't want it too much. Of them to lead the eye up. So if we have that green going up the sides a little bit and we have the green in the topper, then we want to make sure we have just a little kiss of green in here. OK, Okay, we're going to work on our pumpkin now. We're going to do the dry brushing technique, and I'm going to start with persimmon. I want this kind of juicy on my brush. So I've got juicy, juicy paint, and I'm going to flick on my paper towel. I'm going to start where my color would be brightest. And I'm going to use shape following strokes, and I'm not going to take it all the way over to that shadow line. I'll reload as I need to. Always click on your paper towel. I'm skimming the paint. This is Patty's favorite dry brush. And I'm just skimming that color, and that is going to make everybody get along really, really, really nicely. Use the edge of my brush over here. I'm going to use the whatever color this is, Bittersweet Chocolate, to deepen the shading on our pumpkin. Okay, when you have to poke holes in your paint and then it gets all across your brush because you can't float because you had to poke a hole, it's time to get fresh paint out. Sometimes I'm the most stubborn person I know. I added some green leaves and stems. We're going to float on here. Get around, join those things right together. Do it round, so we got to go around the top. Fall is my favorite season. I think everybody says that though. Okay, now we've got that nice and separated. I'm liking how that's turning out, but now we need to get it more highlighted. I don't want to lose my pumpkin into my leaf pile though, so we've got to keep it a little bit on the dark side. Now we'll shade to definitely keep it out of the leaf pile. Separates and brings things forward and back. Now we need to get a little bit more sunshiny color. I'm going to go into camel. I think this is going to be, I'm going to do camel plus persimmon. I think just the one is just going to be too big a jump. I can go through my leaf. That's not a problem. I put them there just to see how they'd look. Anyway, now I'll go straight camel. Okay, so. And then into bleach sand. Bleach sand seems to have moved in to become our mother color for this project. Now what I can do if I think my highlights have gotten too bright is I can go back in and I can give this a wash of a color. Okay, next we're going to make our twisted stem. So let's talk a little bit about twisted stems. I'm going to switch to my white Ghost Rider. Scooch in. Okay, so we'll make this cross in front of this. Okay, Now the stem is going to come up and it's going to kind of twist around. And so what I'm going to do is we're going to go and highlight. And then it twists around here, it comes around the back, and it comes back around. Okay, so we'll just doing little hash marks. On our leaves, we'll go ahead and highlight those. I'm just going to just give them a little dry brush. Don't want too much going on. We want to highlight our stem. Just tickling on a little bit of color. A little bit of detail. Not so much. We'll go into, I don't even have a brighter green on my palette, so we'll mix some bleach sand with this. And then within these, give them a little bit more highlight. A little bit more highlight over here on the green. Okay, it's just like magical kind of little stuff happening there. We'll get out our plantation pine. That'll be our shadow color. I can add it in between. Add it under. I'm just using a liner brush to kind of sketch this color in. I can just bring it around and even create my shading. Same thing here. I'm going to pick one side. And I'll just put that little line right on in there to indicate shading. I can flatten out the Raphael. I can add a little bit of stem. Okay, and I think we'll call that enough busyness there. Okay, the next thing I want to do is go ahead and redden up. I'm not sure that's a word, but we'll pretend like it is. Base down here with a glaze. A glaze is simply a washy kind of float that goes over colors that's transparent. I just want that extra little separation. It's just going to be a little glaze down its side, keeping it off of my leaf. And it's that hint of something going on that draws your eye, but you don't know what brought it down there. And I'll bring it up and in. We'll glaze a little bit with the same red in here. I think our apple will be a little more apple-y. Okay. Now you'll go through, when you get done, don't think just because you got through all the steps that you're finished. When you get done with the painting, what you're going to do is you need to go through and say, oh, I like this shading, and you look at it and you just kind of make sure that, like I went through and shaded one more time here because I didn't think it was dark enough. So go through and balance out your painting. I haven't got my highlight on here. Those are all just the repeats of what we did before. but now his hand is there. Okay,
we gotta do the gun.
The gun needs to be highlighted down the middle of the stock, and I'm gonna go ahead and use camel. I'll use camel. And what I'm gonna do is I'm just going to dry brush and shape following movements with the camel. Okay, that's just gonna give me that highlight. Nice and skinny all the way down the gun. I'm gonna trace on my pattern still. We're gonna take our number 6 curve flat. I hope you're loving how much control you get with these brushes. They're crazy control. I'm gonna use this dry kind of float that we used for his eyes because I want it skinny. Okay, gonna just nice and floaty float float. Okay, and then I'll shade the other side. And then we'll shade up here at the on the top. Now this will get a little bit wider because it's got a bigger turn. We'll shade under his hand and over his hand as well. And we'll walk it down just a little bit to show that it's shadowed. You can even pull it down. All right, I want to do just a tiny little rub kiss kind of thing of cherry red here and there. I want to go into his coat. I'm going to put a little bit in his coat. In the shadow area. He needs just a little bit more electricity. That just brings the heat up. Keep it out of your highlight area or you'll get pink. I've got a little bit glazed on my pumpkin bottom. I could put a little bit in his pants leg. Okay. A little bit here and there. You decide. You're the boss. I could give him just a little bit more color in his cheeks. I'm liking it. Okay, guess what? The star of the show, Mr. Turkey Lurkey. All right, so I've got him already kind of traced on there. I'm just going to go ahead and shade to separate. I'm going to shade with, and this will be my first painted turkey, so be gentle on me. Okay, so we're going to shade behind the guy, so we'll get that over with right now. Sink him in. And then we'll shade. He's got to have his elements shaded, so we'll shade to separate the feathers. And we'll shade his wing. And we'll shade to sink him in. Where are you? Sink him in the weeds here in our weeds. It's got to be simple, otherwise it's going to be all about the turkey. Now you could have some fun with a turkey, but this guy is hiding, so we shouldn't be able to see him too well. And I'm fighting that color in there. I'm just nudging it in there. That's what I'm loving about this brush. I can lead. It's like an angle shader flat stroke brush. Hot diggity dog. Okay, I'm going to shade over the wing as well. And I need to shade around his little head. Just to keep it separate. And I have to figure out what all this comb and wattle stuff does. Figure it out. I'm going to to take Camel and my dry brush, and I'm gonna dry brush his head to lighten it up. Shape following strokes. Can kind of stipple a little bit. His head and his neck. Okay, one more time. Gives him a good basis for a head. Then we're going to create some of this texture on him. If I can tuck everything around so I can get a good angle on it. So I'm going to make rows of feather texture, just setting down my Patty's Favorite dry brush in staggering rows. Okay, and that gives him a little bit of texture. And I'm going to do the same thing on his body. I want to mind my roundness. And kind of cup it around so that it pretends like it's going round. Brush my brush. Okay, now the turkey's got some little feathery things going on. We could go into bleached sand on just the ones that are in the highlightiest spots. And we could make them be the highlights. I had a dirty brush. I gotta wash that out. I got some pink in there, but you know what? We're not gonna care. All right, across the back of the tail, that can be more of a just a base coat. And we can have him variegated coming down. Okay, and then we'll highlight that tip. I want to be careful not to have that disappear. We'll highlight his head with the light bleach sand. All right, I want to give his beak its little bit of, I'm going to shade it with just like a dry brush coming out. Oops, not like that. Okay, and then we'll go into Camel and we'll highlight back. Keep my banner out of my paint. Okay, now he's got a little yellow beak. We'll take that turkey waddle. And we'll dry brush some of our red. It's more of a wash, I think. We could give our turkey some, oh, a little bit of teal in his tail feathers. Skimming that color in. We all know that turkeys can be some pretty strange colors. And we'll just do a little bit at the base of him. Just scribbling that in with a very dry brush. And that gives him just a little bit more of a family color. Maybe he needs a little bit of something going on there. office head top there. We'll give a little bit of an eye spot. And then we'll go ahead and find our brush, which is missing. Here it is. And give him a black eye. And we know it has to have a shine, which is best to do as soon as your paint is dry because it's hard to get it to stick. Really a tiny little shine. You could also give him a little shine on his beak. And we could shine on his wattle a little bit.
Now I've masked the parts I don't want to have spattered with some tracing paper. I'm going to get out my White Wonder. I'm going to use today the half inch. And I'll go into some of my burnt umber. And I'll liquid it down. And I'll grab a fat brush. And then I'm going to tap here to the edges, being careful around that I don't get paint on things I don't want paint on. I have a little bit wider spatters around here. I'm gonna spatter with my white, same deal, in my middle area. Get him a little magical. Now I've got little dots on my gun stock that I don't want. So I'm gonna take a Q-tip, run that over that and clean him up. So now I'll remove this carefully so that I don't run wet dots together, and being careful where I'm going to put it, because right next to me I have another finished product. It's got a couple of speckles on his shirt. Okay. So I think I can like that. Now I think we need to have some spatters down here. I think those need to be in traditional burnt sienna. Okay. And then I think we need to do a little of that pale gold as well, because I think the pale gold adds a festive look. So I'll take pale gold powder, and I'm gonna move him over so you can see my messy, 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 messy palette. I'll get rid of this, but I'm gonna save it because all my colors are out on it. We'll use some gloss varnish. We'll put our gloss varnish out. We'll take some gold powders. Mix them together, and then I'll put a little water in with. Cover my powders. You don't want to get liquid in your powders because it will tarnish the powders. Put it on the edges of my leaves. And then we've got to do a little bit coming up the side. I don't want it in the guy though. And now I've got a glass mixing palette down here. I'm going to take my detail knife that just goes on my fingertip, take the blade off, and then I'm just going to follow along. All of my hands will stop sticking, and my dots are still wet. Okay, so I'll follow along all my details, and just finger, super sharp blade. That's why I use this one. It's the sharpest thing I've ever seen. But you'll do that, as I'll do it as soon as my dots are dry.
and cut out all of the little leaves from edge to edge.